costs of finishing the ill-fated bath spa project rise again.
So flaky paint continues to stall the opening of the bath spa project.
The long-awaited opening has been pushed back again.
Almost £25 million over budget, 5 years behind schedule, and way out of favour with the people on its doorstep, you and me.
Thermae Bath Spa, as it will soon come to be known, is due to open in April of next year. But given its chequered past, can it really ever survive? Well, Inside Out West decided it was time to investigate.
For this mission, I'm sending in a special agent, my James Bond of the business world. From humble beginnings in the Northeast, flogging ice cream, to multi-millionaire businessman, Duncan Bannatyne is now worth a cool £135 million, almost twice as much as Posh and Bex. This tough-talking entrepreneur owns a string of health clubs and a casino. Clearly a leisure industry giant and someone well qualified for this assignment. Armed with facts and figures, Duncan sets off to meet the key players, examine the delays, look at the books, and give his expert opinion on whether the spa will sink or swim.
Taking the waters has been central to the life of this city for the last two millennia. But when a potentially lethal bug was found in the waters in 1978, Bath's unique hot springs were forced to close.
Since then, the buildings have fallen into rack and ruin. No private business dared touch the spa. It was too great an investment and too much of a risk. In 1996 came the chance of lottery funding and salvation, or so everyone thought. But from day one, the project hasn't run smoothly. There were delays, lots of them, from a nesting duck to an archaeological dig. They all mounted up until August 2003, one of the biggest nights Bath has ever seen. The three tenors are invited here to give a gala performance for the opening of the Bath Spa. Every ticket sold, the great and the good turn up, Pavarotti sounds splendid, and fireworks light up the night sky.
It's the perfect night here at the Royal Crescent, bar one thing. The Bath Spa didn't actually open.
No sooner had the three tenors accepted their invite than a disturbing discovery was made. The pool paint was peeling, yet another false start, and clearly not much to sing about. Duncan is here investigating if the spa will ever be a success. His assignment begins on a tour of the site where he joins a group of locals.
At the Lazarus Bath, or the Leper's Bath, is here. You see this wonderful new bath in front of us now.
Well, is this bath finished now? Is it this, correct paint and everything?
This one's finished.
Here we are with the thermal waters. We should be going out and competing with the great spas in the world, Baden-Baden and Kiev, and really bringing the tourists in. I think the damage has been huge from the lack of finishing of this building, and whether we'll ever get the tourists back is another matter.
I think it's a matter of there's times of the year when we can accommodate more tourists, and there's just times of the year whenever Bath is actually relatively full. So we'll be certainly focusing on those, in particular the winter months.
You like to come this way?
What you've made it is, if I'm unkind, a modern monstrosity. If I'm kind, a modern interest. I mean, I have a lot of respect for Nicholas Grimshaw. I think he's a great architect. I just think he had brain fever when he did this.
As one of the leading architects of the 21st century and designer of the new Bath Spa, Sir Nicholas Grimshaw decided to give us his first TV interview since all the setbacks in 2003.
So this facility has a swimming pool in the basement, a swimming pool in the ceiling. Can you tell us about the concept a little bit?
Well, I mean, the concept was to do a really modern piece of architecture in Bath, which would be interesting in its own right, so people would want to come and see it. But equally, to make it a building which really did fit in and kind of was sympathetic to the Bath materials. We used quite a lot of Bath stone. And the basic concept was very simple. It's a stone cube standing on four huge columns which go into the lower pool at the base of it. And then in that cube are wonderful kind of steam rooms with terrific lighting and aromas in them.
Well, as you know, I've got 37 swimming pools in my health clubs, and I actually get complaints from members when there's a window that people can see in from the car park.
Well, I suppose you can, I suppose that's one of those things where you have to see how things go once you open up and see. The operator of this setup has done spas before, and he has quite strong views about this. And I think he wants the inside-outside kind of relationship.
What impact do you think this will have in Bath, similar to the impact that the Millennium Wheel has had in London?
Well, I hope so. I think it'll be quite an iconic building. I think people visiting Bath will really want to come and look at this. It'll be on their sort of visitor route. But I do think that sitting in the hot pool on the roof, looking out over Bath, will be one of the real experiences of a lifetime.
Bath was once a tourist hotspot. In 1997, it was ranked the seventh most visited place in Britain by overseas tourists. Now, though, the city is struggling to stay in the top 20, with places like Cardiff pulling in more punters. The spa was set to change all that. It was heralded as an economic lifeline. Yet from the start, it's been draining energy and resources and dragging Bath's name through the mud.
This has been a classic case of a council failing to take the necessary decisions and letting this project drag on at vast expense to local council taxpayers.
Concerned with poor local support and negative PR, Duncan jets to Holland to meet the operators. When it comes to running luxury facilities like these, they've got knowledge and experience in spades. But is that going to be enough when it comes to handling the blighted Bath Spa? Duncan meets the MD, whose investment is gradually evaporating. Henk Verschuur is the man fitting a bill of almost £7 million. But with the spa draining investment and still no returns, can it really be a lucrative project?
Henk, this project is 5 years out of date. You've stuck with it all the way through. You're still there, hanging on. You've sold this place and a few others to help finance it. Originally, you agreed to invest £5.2 million. Now you've increased by 25%, you have to invest £6.5 million. Yeah. How are you financing that?
It's extremely important if you start a business that your partners have deep pockets and they are willing to go in the pockets. Otherwise, you will have a problem. And my partners are financially very, very strong, so I don't worry.
It was originally suggested the day price ticket would be £35. Now it's been increased to £45, a 28% increase, much greater than inflation. Do you think that will alienate the local population?
The full day price is a small part of my visitors. The spa is a city spa. And a day city spa, you can't spend all the time the whole day. So we are focusing on 2 hours and 4 hours mainly. Okay. So this encourages a little bit the whole day stayers.
Henk's no stranger to risk-taking. He was at the forefront of spa culture in Holland when he opened his own hot baths in the remote town of Van der Valk 10 years ago. He proved out as wrong when the euros came flooding in. This dream netted him a fortune. But can he do the same in Bath?
One of the big problems at Bath Spa appears to be the paint. So why can you paint this and get it right and then in Bath it goes wrong? What happens?
Oh, what happened was, at that time, they chose to go for another paint. So they didn't more or less listen to my advice. So they chose for another type of paint with no track record.
What reason did they have for using a different paint?
I think budget reasons.
It was cheaper?
It was a little bit cheaper.
So they saved some money?
Not anymore. Yeah.
How much would they have saved?
70,000.
I heard about 70,000,
yeah.
But now it's probably cost them about 4 or 5 or 10 million.
More than 4 million.
So you still believe in it?
Yes.
No regrets?
Not at all. Not at all. Well, I have to be very honest. If it was hindsight, maybe I wouldn't have done it.
You wouldn't have done it?
No, of course. Yeah. Because if I knew that, it would take me 6 years.
Another financial backer is the Millennium Commission. They've supported the spa through spiralling costs and delays. Though unlike the operators, if the spa fails, the Millennium Commission get their £7.8 million investment back.
We're very disappointed at the delay. It should have been opened years ago, and the fact that people are not benefiting from lottery money now concerns us greatly. We still have confidence in the project, and we think it can be delivered. And we think if when it's open, it will be popular, it will be an icon. You cannot just look at the economics of the project itself. You've got to look at the knock-on effect about the people it attracts to Bath, what it means for local hotels, for local restaurants. And tourism is central to Bath's economy.
So, how crucial are visitors to the city and to the success of the spa? Duncan does his homework and unearths an interesting fact. Overnight stays by foreign tourists have dropped by 25% in the last 10 years. Now that can't be good news for the spa. He arranges to meet Nicolo Flauti, the councillor responsible for tourism and a key player in the spa project.
Originally in your business plan, it was suggested there were 1 million overnight visitors in Bath. Is that correct?
That is correct.
Well, according to the Southwest Tourism Intelligence Project, there are only 743,000.
Now, the business plan was done in 97. And as I explained to you, the importance of tourism, it is falling down. The numbers are falling down, but the take is increased because people spend more. We need to bring back Bath to the level it used to be. But since 97, there's been a number of events. You know, there's been BSE, there's been September the 11th, and people are more frightened to travel.
There's so many people in Bath, I've been speaking to them, and some of them are telling me they're very unhappy because they believe they're paying extra tax to fund this through the council tax.
When it was first started, there was a huge, huge support from the local community. They didn't want the hot water. You know, 1 million gallon a day of hot water was just coming down this river. And they didn't like that. They felt it was in their inheritance which was going down. But if you look at the whole project and everything the local authority is doing, the spa contributes a very small amount of our capital expenditure.
Well, some people say that that capital expenditure could have went to schools and improved them rather than the spa. What do you say to that?
Yes, we do that. I mean, the local authority has many, many responsibilities. Mm. We are building 3 schools, we are building 2 elderly people's homes. We are still doing that. But we've also got a need and a responsibility to make sure that the economic vibrancy of the area continues. You know, Bath is not going to be a museum. It's got to live, it's got to be vibrant.
Before any work could begin in salvaging the spa and its sacred waters, the council had to draw up a building contract. They chose to take hands-on control of the project, but in doing so, they also took on responsibility for all the costs.
Who made that decision and why?
The contract. Mm. The contract was a contract that the Millennium Commission insisted in. Once they give money, they gave us 7.8 million, and it was their contract that we had to use. And also, I mean, I have seen some of your centres, and it is very different to what we are talking about. We are talking of a very difficult building, very sensitive building, in the centre of a World Heritage Site.
That's exactly why I would have done a build-design contract right from the beginning. Then the builder has a fixed price, and he's got to find ways around those little problems. It's the same amount of money, no matter what he does.
Duncan's surprised by the council's choice of contract, and even more surprised when the Millennium Commission informs him they had nothing to do with the contract. Even at this early stage, it's clear to our business expert the spend on the building could have been plugged. Struggling to understand how costs have soared, Duncan meets John Betty. He's been drafted in as the council's troubleshooter. If anyone knows about funding, surely it'll be him.
Originally, the council's expenditure on this would have been 3 million, and now it's gone to 22 million. That's a big difference. How do you justify that?
Well, I think actually it's for nearer 20, but I mean, it is a big difference. It is difficult to justify in purely financial terms, but in value terms, this scheme is going to bring so much more activity to the city. It's going to address some of the issues that you mentioned about the visitor numbers, and it's going to give people something to be engaged in and revitalise the city.
It's an amazing story when you read through the Bath Spa what's happened there all the way through.
but £40 million is gone. Where has it gone?
Well, I think it's gone to a large degree in obviously increased cost because of the length of the period. It's certainly gone to a large degree in advice from both sides. And I don't think anybody could say that that is the ideal way in which we'd want to spend it. But I still don't believe that that reduces the value of the project.
And the council believe the impact of the spa will be even more wide-reaching than the city centre. Here, in this disused wasteland south of the city, there are plans for a £1 billion development, and the spa is seen as the catalyst.
Now, the council had an opportunity 5 years ago this month to walk away and write off £4 million. Do you think they made the wrong decision?
No, I don't. I think they made absolutely the right decision. I think in life you have to be brave, you have to see the greater opportunity. And I think the thing that people may be forgetting in this, that councils are here for very long periods of time. This council's been here probably 500-600 years. You have to take the very long view of these things. And as I've said earlier, Bath has historically always leapt forward at the regeneration of the waters and the spa, and those waters had not been used for 30 years.
Well, the people won't be happy until they can put it behind them, and they can't do that until it's opening. Now, you've said it's going to open April 2006, so are you confident enough on the April date to put your job on the line? Say, if it's not open in April, I'm resigning, I'm off.
Well, I don't think it'll be me that's putting my job on the line. I think it'll be me saying it will be open in April, subject to all the circumstances that I can stand here and say today.
I've decided to schedule a rendezvous with my business super sleuth right here in the city centre to see if you can give me an update on the latest developments. Duncan, you've already met a couple of the key players attached to the spa. What surprised you the most?
Well, it's only my second day investigating this, and already I'm finding inconsistencies. Not inconsistencies that are historic, but the head of tourism said to me they couldn't sign a fixed price contract because the Millennium Commission wouldn't let them. I asked the Millennium Commission, they said, we don't get involved in the contract. I asked the new guy who came in, I said, John, did you sign a fixed price contract? He said, yes, we did sign a fixed price contract, but the problem was there was more than 2,000 revisions. Then he told me they were opening in April. He told me three times they were opening in April. Now, when I asked Hank about the opening date in April, he said, well, nobody's told me they're opening in April. So I said to John, Hank says you haven't told him. He says, yes, I have. So they're already disagreeing with each other.
Now, you're a seasoned businessman. Are inconsistencies like these, are they normal? Are they standard practice?
No, they're not, and they should always be resolved by someone who's in charge, either the project manager or the architect. There should be somebody there who takes responsibility and keeps it together. And there wasn't any like that in this project. It took 5 years to bring John Beatty in. Before he came in, there was just nobody.
So in your opinion, that's been the main problem, has it? A lack of one accountable key player?
Absolutely, yeah. They needed one accountable key player. I think they've just been trying to run on a committee of councillors. And nobody's heads rolled, nobody's actually been fired, but if one gets taken off that job, somebody else is put in the job, and they just kept changing it around.
With tools down for the day, Duncan gets a more extensive tour of the building. He's an expert when it comes to health clubs. He's worked with architects and builders, constructing 37 of his own.
You've got the main shape of the pool with jacuzzis, air beds, neck massages coming behind you, and the water comes up and flows over.
So is the changing room on this floor?
No, the changing room's lower down again.
Lower down, so you have to use that.
Again, this is a whole day experience. It's not a rush around anywhere. It's take your time is the point of the building.
Well, I understand that. I just feel that people walking about with wet towels are going to get the stairs wet and the lift wet, and you're going to have massive problems.
Yeah, again, it's the operator's regime that's going to keep that clean.
People will slip going down the stairs and they'll hurt themselves and they'll sue you.
Will they?
I predict that. I promise you that will happen.
I haven't got an answer to that, because that will be something we'll have to address at the time.
And I'll tell you something even worse.
Mm-hmm.
People will pretend to slip and hurt themselves and sue you. And it's serious.
Especially now they're giving you the idea.
I've had a health club with a swimming pool and the change room were in different floors.
Yeah.
And it's a nightmare. I actually moved it.
Really? Yeah. Mm. Well, again, these things we've got to be learn about how we do it, how we're going to keep it clean, or how it's kept clean and how it works. But sticking with the water where it is, we've got to have the building here, we've got to go up, we can't go out.
So Duncan's far from impressed that the changing area seems to be on a different level from that of the swimming or the steam areas. In his experience, it's practicalities like these that so often get overlooked in the beginning, and later, once the building's finished, can land a business in really hot water.
Duncan's fixed a meeting with Mike Ward from Molum, the construction company which, until April, was building the spa. In a surprising turn of events, Molum was sacked by the council and told to leave the site. But before relations broke down, they offered the local authority a deal.
For a total fee of £26 million, nothing else, having all's dropped, you would finish the job in July last year.
Yes, July this year.
July this year.
Yes.
And if it wasn't finished, you'd pay a penalty clause for every week it was let.
Yes.
That seems to me like a good resolution.
We thought it was. We thought that, well, there were several surveys carried out. The people of Bath themselves were interviewed. The construction journals were interviewed. BBC carried out a poll. And everybody, I believe it's anything up to 88% of the people thought it was the best way forward.
Even with my limited knowledge of the construction industry, I've built over 100 buildings, but most of them have been brand new. My view is this should have been a build design contract right from day one.
We offered, even before the contract started, when they were trying to do cost savings, to actually do the contract on a design and build basis, in which case Baines would then have had a guaranteed price, no risk, and a definitive completion date.
I mean, just to explain, even with design and build, it doesn't mean you can move the swimming pool from here to there or make it smaller.
No, no.
It's still constrained by the actual original design.
Yes.
It means on site you can make some small alterations. But in this case, you had to send it back round the council, round the houses and back again.
Yes.
Taking a lot of time.
Yes.
Costing a lot more money.
Yes.
The project has been hit by numerous delays and the opening date has already been moved back several times.
Parties involved with the Bath Spa project are continuing to talk about how best to deal with the flaky paint problem.
With the succession of delays and failed openings, operators Thermae Bath Spa took the marketing decision to distance themselves from the project, and it's only now they're actively promoting it.
Many Bathonians have told me they're not going to use it. They said they're sick and tired of it. But you say you're going to convince them different, so it's supposed to open in April. If it does or doesn't, is it sink or swim?
Well, we'll certainly convince Bathonians over a period of time to come and visit. It's an important market, but not a critical market to our success. So moving on to the sink or swim scenario, we must definitely swim. And it'll be a very relaxing, enjoyable experience.
Well, you see, you know what it's about, and you know what the £45 for. But the public out there don't, not the ones I've spoken to. So how are you going to get the message to them and convince them? And when you do convince them, how are you going to get them to park their cars? Where are they going to park? I've never seen such a facility with no car parking spaces in my life.
There'll always be some people who don't like it and think it's too expensive. Those people we appreciate that we have to work on over years one, two, three, and beyond. As to transport, then yes, transport is certainly a thorny issue for Bath in general. Assuming that you can get in for car parking, on a wet, grey, horrible day, what better environment to spend it than in the spa? I mean, it's a fantastic. I mean, if ever there was a weather system geared up for using spa, bathing outside in 33, 34 degrees of thermal water, a fantastic environment.
You're a good salesman, David, and a good talker, but I've seen Millennium projects before that have closed down, and there's one not far from me, funded by the lottery, that was opened in a blaze of glory, no car parking facilities, and now it's lying closed and derelict and boarded up. Do you think this is really going to work? Do you think you're really going to make some money at this?
Most definitely, and picking you up again on the transporting, we have millions of visitors who come to Bath every year, so we do have the volume. We're not looking for new business markets. We're utilising the existing business visitors.
Well, there's a problem there. In the original application, it said there was 1 million overnight visitors in Bath. That's now 743,000. It's a big drop, isn't it? 25%.
Between October and March every year, we'll see a downturn in those numbers you're referring to. And so if the bed and breakfast, from a bed and breakfast operator to a hotel environment, can actually then target that the spa is part of a potential marketing policy for them to increase their bed nights, then there's mutual benefit on both parties.
Duncan's still far from convinced the spa's going to pull in punters. To keep afloat, a successful business needs customers. And at 45 quid a day, gut instinct tells Duncan prices are just too high. To test the market, he gives 100 people the choice between three fun days out, with each option similarly priced and represented by a different statue.
If I gave you between £45 and £50 to spend today and said you had to spend it today, would you spend it on a three-course meal at a Michelin-star restaurant, a day at the new Thermae Spa, which has waters with healing powers that you can bathe in a huge steam room, or a day at Longleat Safari Park, which includes a champagne cream tea and tours in the rowboat.
I'd take my wife for a meal.
On you go then. What would you spend your money on?
A Longleat thing.
You put your money in a Longleat bucket, and you put your money in a Bath Spa bucket.
I'd go for the Longleat, I'd go for the cream tea with the...
Put your money in your mouth, is.
Okay.
Thank you.
The spa.
Dinner thing.
Dinner. You put your coin in a dinner box?
Definitely.
I would actually choose to go to Longleat, but...
What?
I may go to the spa just to see what the controversy is about. Duncan.
Yes.
You've been hard at it, accosting the public. What's the verdict?
Well, amazingly, the spa has won it with a resounding 43% of the votes. Second in place was 37%, so it's done fantastic.
Are you sure that's not your smooth Scottish selling techniques?
Well, I didn't have any preferred option, so I just says, put your money where your mouth is, and that's what they did.
So the idea of the spa, though not open, proved popular with the visitors. But after an in-depth investigation, what's our expert's conclusion?
Last time we talked, you were guns blazing, ready to go and talk to a few more of the key players. How have you got on?
That's right. Well, I met with David Rawlings first from TDC. He's the marketing manager. He's convinced this is going to work. And he's the guy who's got to sell the tickets. And he says he's going to get 250 people through the door every day to make it pay. I don't know how he can do it. There's no car parking. I spoke to the councillor. They said, it's 10 minutes to the nearest car park. I said, yeah, but I went to the nearest car park in my car and I drove around and I couldn't find a space. It took me half an hour to find a car parking space anywhere near the spa.
And that's before the spa's open?
That's before it opens. And if it's going to flood in new tourists, we're in big trouble.
Now, if you were a local, if you came from Bath, would you dip your big toe into that spa?
I would dip my toe in. I'd go once. I'd spend £45 on it, but I wouldn't spend £2 million. I wouldn't buy it. In fact, if he gave it to me for absolutely nothing, I don't think I could make it pay.
So hang on a minute. Bath Spa, 2005, sink or swim?
I've tried to be optimistic. I've tried to think as much as I could about how best to do it, but really, sink. The best thing you can do is knock it down, build a multi-storey car park.
So hang on a minute, the man with the Midas touch, you say build a multi-storey car park instead of the Bath Spa.
It's the only way you can make it pay. Somebody's got to subsidise it. It can't make a profit.
How many years are we going to see the Bath Spa open here for?
2, 3, 5, it depends how much money the Dutch people throw at it. The operators, they're going to throw money at it each year until they suddenly give up.
And we all know there ain't much money left in the kitty.
There's none at all.
So Duncan's work here is done. He's encouraged the spa came top in the street poll and by the commitment to get it finished. Yet he's convinced the problems aren't going to end when it opens. He says it's the design and lack of parking that will be the spa's undoing. And he's certain that without added funding, this business doesn't have a future. It's an investment without rewards. In Duncan's opinion, this costly project is destined for a watery grave. On next week's programme, Joan Collins' daughter and her love affair with Western Supermare. Plus, mobile speed cameras, are they convicting innocent drivers? And, ooh la la, could this man be the last of the Onion Johnnies to come knocking at your door?
Thanks a lot for joining us for this special Inside Out West. Of course, we'll be back next week with those three stories. And in the meantime, it's goodbye from Bath.